Chapter 10, When Life Intrudes. Life can only be understood backwards, but it must be lived forwards. Quote from Søren Kierkegaard, 1813 to 1855. Finding time to study when there is none. Life is full of interruptions. Unfortunately, being a medical student doesn't protect you from these occurrences. Your workload in your preclinical years increases dramatically. There's never enough time to do everything, and finding the time to study for step one when there is none can be quite challenging. The bottom line is, you have to make a plan that includes unplanned interruptions, and you have to stick to it. In Eat That Frog, author Brian Tracy discusses how to get important things done fast. The title of his book is based on words attributed to Mark Twain. If you eat a frog first thing in the morning, the rest of your day will be wonderful. What he's really saying is that if you organize your day and tackle your most important task first, then you'll feel a greater satisfaction and sense of accomplishment. In case you haven't figured it out yet, USMLE step one is your frog. The first thing you need to do to tackle this task is to plan and set your priorities wisely. The best way to devise a study plan is to get a timer, set it for 15 minutes, then take a sheet of paper and make a list of everything on your mind right now. When the timer goes off, take a breather and see how you feel. Everything cluttering your mind is now on paper. In a few minutes, you'll be resetting your priorities and you'll be on your way to finding time to study when there is none. Let's take a closer look at procrastination, which is one of the biggest reasons why there never seems to be enough time. Procrastination is defined as to put off something, especially out of habitual carelessness or laziness. Also, to postpone or delay needlessly. Obviously, some procrastination is good and some is bad. We need to know the difference between the two kinds and then be able to do something about the bad. None of us can do everything that needs to get done. You'll end up postponing something, but it's vital that you put off only less important activities and do the hardest task first. In your case, it's going to be getting through the assigned number of questions in your online question bank, writing up the wrongs in your factoid books, and reviewing your factoid books, etc. Self-discipline. Training and control of oneself and one's conduct, usually for personal improvement. The most obvious thing that can be said about the term self-discipline is that it has something to do with change and hard work. Self-discipline sounds like an old-fashioned concept. And it may be. But a lot of people have achieved their goals because of it. I surmise that your determination and hard work got you into medical school. Even though the application process, interviews, and waiting for an acceptance letter may seem so long ago. I include the definition of self-discipline in this chapter because you're going to need it when life intrudes, and it will. Preparing for your step one exam will be hard work. Why? Because putting off studying for it until the last minute is the usual modus operandi. I'm too busy to study for step one. I have final exams coming up. I do great on standardized exams. I always wait till the last minute. And in the words of that great philosopher, Alfred E. Newman, what? Me worry? Mad Magazine, 1955. If you don't view the USMLE Step 1 exam as challenging and you blow off the hard work it'll take to pass it, then you should be worried. This is where the ideas from Eat That Frog come in. When you do the work in a disciplined way, you lay the foundation for studying for future multiple choice examinations that will come into your life over and over again. Remember what Brian Tracy, author of Eat That Frog, says. Persistence is actually self-discipline in action. Be persistent in keeping to your goal of being well prepared for step one. Now, we'll look at workload considerations and how to study effectively. You've probably discovered by now that medical school is completely different from your undergraduate experience. In medical school, you sit in lecture halls with the same 100 to 120 plus classmates. You may be in smaller group settings as well, but for the most part, you're linked to the same classmates for most of your first 2 years. The workload is heavier, and the time you need to spend studying after class and on weekends can be all-consuming, and you have lots and lots of tests. Just when you think you've earned a break in the form of a little time off, you start feeling guilty and find yourself hitting the books again. Then, just before your third year starts, you have to take USMLE Step 1. When you start to prepare for step one, your workload changes. You still need to keep up with your courses, but now you have to find time to study for the USMLE as well. you may find yourself more isolated and wondering how to change gears for step one. That's what this book is for. If you start early enough, you can run through the step one online questions as you study for your class exams. And you can write up the wrongs and use your new factoid book as review tool for both exams. Some students find study groups helpful after they've been studying for step one for a while. The increased workload is not going away, so success in medical school is all about finding a way to handle it. Success in studying for step one is starting early. Interruptions aren't going away as you study for your boards. You need to be able to carve out some uninterrupted time to achieve your daily study goals. Perhaps the best way to do this is to make a repeating appointment with yourself and let those around you know that you're unavailable, except in case of an extreme emergency. Set specific times and find a quiet place where you can work without interruption. If you go to the library, consider getting one of those little glassed-in rooms and face away from the door if possible. If you're at home, go to your desk area and put a sign on the door that lets people know you're unavailable. If you're a parent, your spouse will have to keep the little ones occupied elsewhere. The key is to have a predefined start and finish time. When you're done, you can return calls and do all the things that you didn't get done while you were studying for your Step 1 exam. If your friends or family are helping by running interference for you, be sure to find ways to return the favor after your exam. If you're studying at the local coffee or tea hangout, once again, you have to try to position yourself so you're away from the action. Wear headphones, even if you're not listening to music, and try not to make eye contact with everyone who passes by. You are there to study and pass your Step 1 exam. Lattes are okay. One way of avoiding interruptions is to make sure you're sending out the right "Don't interrupt me now" cues. Close your door if you can. Silence your cell phone. Disable or show busy on your instant messenger and chats. If you're busy writing in your factoid book or hammering away at your keyboard, then the message is clear to most people. I'm busy. It's important to look at the problem of interruptions because they're real, and they don't go away without some kind of intervention on your part. The real problem with interruptions is the cost to the work you're doing currently. If you're just signing into your online question bank or reviewing a few pages in your factoid book, then you can start and stop easily. If, however, you're in the middle of a timed online test, or you've finally just figured out why you keep missing the same question over and over again and you need to make some quick notes, you might not be able to get back to the same zone after being interrupted. Saying no to family and friends. One of the hardest things you may have to do while studying for USMLE Step 1 is say no to family and friends. Everyone knows that medical school can be all-consuming, but till now, we've tried to find a balance between classwork and home life. Since many of you aren't in formal Step 1 preparation classes, you must carve out the time to study using whatever free minutes and hours are left. This is really the process of setting boundaries in your life. You can't do everything, and you absolutely have to focus on preparing for your Step 1 exam. It's crucial that you take the time to study now and pay back the time to your family and friends later. I'm not saying you should become a hermit for several months and pop back into your former life the minute you walk out of the test center, but you may have to make some difficult choices. Some likely examples: not being able to go on the entire week-long family vacation. If possible, go for a few days instead. Not being able to see every one of your son's or daughter's soccer games. Try to get to one or two. Get a copy of that schedule and commit to those that are doable. Not being able to spend the weekend in the city with your old college roommates. Take a rain check or commit to Saturday night only and leave early Sunday morning. Sometimes you will cause hurt feelings. I wish it weren't so, but it is. Unless you're married to or dating another medical student who's going through or has recently gone through what you're experiencing, it's possible your significant other, SO, will have a hard time understanding. Most people just can't. For better or worse, the process of becoming a physician is grueling, and at times, the obstacles can feel insurmountable. Even if your significant other's heart is in the right place, the medical school process can change you both. In time, most of us find our old selves again and reclaim the part of us that we had to push aside for a while. Your loved ones will change as well, and they'll forgive you for the things you did, the hurt feelings you caused, and the things you missed out on. Remember, you've worked really hard to get to this place in your medical career. Your family and friends are proud of you and want you to succeed. If you have to say no, remember to emphasize that it's temporary and schedule something to do with them after the exam. It's important to have a plan for those people who aren't in your inner circle, such as friends and relatives who live out of town. If they call and say they'd like to drop in for a stay, direct them to the nearest reasonably priced motel and meet them for dinner or breakfast. If you have a significant other, spouse, partner, etc., he or she will probably be the one running interference for you. So remember to plan something really special for your SO after this is all over. If you find yourself listening to insensitive remarks from other people who think they understand what you're going through but don't have a clue, "It's only a test. When I took it 20 years ago, I barely had to study for it," etc., walk away quickly. You don't need to hear it, and you don't need to deal with it. Forget about it. Also remember, you're not alone. If you need to talk to your classmates about strategies for carving out time, do it. Just don't take too much time. Escape to your third place. Traditionally speaking, the concept of a third place is meant to represent a place other than your home or workspace. Ray Oldenburg, creator of the term, explains in his book, The Great Good Place, that third places are simply informal public gathering places. His concept revolves around the idea that people need informal public places to gather and interact, such as coffee shops and general stores, so they can get to know each other and have a sense of community. In medical school, the library or quad area may become a third place, and in the spirit of the great good place, these may work fairly well. But I have a definition for third place that's different from Mr. Oldenburg's. My meaning has to do with finding a place of solitude, not comradeship. The first time I heard the term third place was at the Maui Writers Retreat. My writing mentor, Sam Horn, told our group about the concept as it pertains to writers. Writers have a process that helps them put pen to paper. In my case, font to screen. Many can write at home after everyone else goes to bed, and some can get up before dawn and write. Others, such as J.K. Rowling of Harry Potter fame, went to her favorite coffee shop and wrote away. I can write in the morning, but I don't have enough time. It seems I just get into it, and it's time to get ready for work. I tried Starbucks in Java City, but I dislike having to pick up my laptop and take it into the restroom so it won't get stolen. Writing at work doesn't do it for me either. As the clinic medical director and teaching attending, there's just too much going on. I found that leaving the house and going to a small apartment works best for me. I can write for a few days, go home and spend time with my family and friends, and then be ready for work on Monday. It might sound extravagant, but it's what I need to do to think and write. My students have had to find their own third place, a place where they can get away from the demands of home and school or work, a place where they know they can study without interruptions. Some students work in the library. Others pick a coffee shop or cafe that's somewhat noisy. They tell me they know that not all test centers are quiet, and they want to get used to the background noises of people pointing and clicking and typing away. Your third place is wherever works best for you. Some students can study at home or in their apartment. Like Stephen King, they've created a third place in their first place. In his book, On Writing, King talks about how he created his writing room in his own home. He also stresses the importance of working in a serene atmosphere. As much as my soul agrees with Professor Oldenburg's concept of a third place as somewhere that people can gather and share stories, we must not go there when it's time to study for step one. It's vital that you find a third place that's more like a writer's refuge to focus on your step one preparation. When it's time for a break, go find one of Oldenburg's great good places and share conversation and community with all your heart. Crisis Management 101. There is a great web resource that deals with students in crisis management. It's a Peace Corps resource adaptation by Safety. Safety Abroad First Educational Travel Information, found at www.globaled.us. No one really talks about crisis management and the USMLE, but I've seen students thrown into chaos during unexpected events. Some of my students have had to deal with family members' illnesses and deaths, feelings of helplessness and worry as friends and families face disasters half a world away, the death of a classmate, or the sudden breakup of a committed relationship. We can't plan for everything, but it's helpful to have a general approach to certain types of crises. Most of the crises my students have experienced are more of a personal nature rather than regional, national, or international. The main theme has been family medical emergency. As noted in the safety resource, most crises have several things in common. They can result in a disruption or early termination of study. They usually cause significant emotional stress, resulting in predictable cognitive, physical, and behavioral reactions. They can be managed with the appropriate support and preparation. If a crisis occurs, try to remain calm. In most cases, as the identified medical student, your family and your friends who aren't in med school already see you as the one who knows what to do. Even if you're not sure, put your training, experience, and insight into action. If a relative has collapsed, be sure to perform your basic life support and have someone call 911 or emergency services. It's amazing how many families are afraid to call for help. If one of your grandparents has died unexpectedly, your family and friends may look to you for answers. If your child or spouse is injured, you're expected to fix it or do the right thing. Then, in the aftermath of crisis, you're expected to keep studying and take your exam as scheduled, essentially pretending that nothing out of the ordinary has happened. In actuality, things have changed. You have changed. And you need to talk it over with your faculty coach. I've seen my students reluctant to mention anything about a family crisis because they didn't want to get off target with their study plan. As their faculty coach, I've helped them make the hard decisions. Take a few days off to be at the hospital with family. Postpone the exam and/or notify the appropriate authorities at the dean's office or student affairs. Remember, a true crisis can happen to anyone. It's important to try to plan as best you can, even if it's something as basic as remaining calm and getting help. Talk to your faculty coach so he or she can help you figure out a solution and find any additional resources, psychological, administrative, etc., you might need. With appropriate support and a little preparation, most crises can be managed, even those that interfere with USMLE Step 1 preparation.